Alan, Alessandro, venite. Noi ci siamo praticamente mangiati il tempo della tavola rotonda, però a questo punto una domanda ce la facciamo per uno. Prego, venite, venite con noi. Dato, alcune sono arrivate anche via Twitter. Cesare, first of all, let's start with you. What about Italy? I mean, what about economic complexity for Italy, economic diversity? It's huge, I think, for my country. So why are we experiencing such a way, such a difficult times now? You know that we just proposed, the government just proposed a terrible bill for economic and financial stability just 2 days ago. Can you just foresee our future looking at your indicator?
So I think I'm mic'd up. So the situation of Europe is very interesting, and it's one that I've been thinking about a lot in the recent time, and Italy obviously is an important actor here. So Italy, when it comes to economic complexity, first we can say that in Italy probably there's like very two well-defined countries, okay? There is a country that is very complex, that is kind of close to the Alps, and there's a country that is less complex, that is closer to the Mediterranean and North Africa. You know, so you see that difference actually, and we've looked at that. We have actually one student a few years ago actually made a paper in which it looked at the two Italies in the product space, and they're very differently located, you know. So there is that internal tension, I think, that exists within the country. Then there are other factors, you know, that one thing is the complexity of the private sector, which in Italy is still relatively high, especially here in the north. Another thing is the amount of expenditure that you have in the public sector. And I think one problem that many countries in Europe have had, you know, some more than others, is that the public sector expenditure has been huge. Like Greece is one example of that. In Greece, the public sector expenditure is so out of whack that if they don't rein in that a bit, you know, they're not going to be able, you know, to get their act together. So I think that there are important differences between some countries. For example, Italy, I would say, that is a country that, in the point of view of economic complexity, has a more solid foundation than Spain, Portugal, and Greece. But in the public sector side, they definitely need to get their act together, and that's something that is going to take, you know, some restraint.
So we can be quite confident about the future. Not so confident, but I mean, to be positive enough.
You have to be, definitely you have to be positive, and the private sector has to be positive. It has been a private sector that has been dynamic, and they have to keep on, you know, pushing their difficult times. But Italy is a country that is plenty. It has plenty of skills and capabilities that they have to keep on building on.
But is your index about economic diversity taken into serious political consideration now? I mean, it's a tool for government, for policy.
So let me give you like a couple of like ideas, and then you make the conclusion. So, for example, we launched the book in October at an event at Harvard. The people that came to comment on the book in the panel was the chief economist of the World Bank, the chief economist of the Asian Development Bank, and the finance minister of Pakistan, and also a very high person of the OECD. So the book is very well known in multilaterals, and actually like a lot of people in high office knows it. It's relatively new, but it also presents a different, you know, a different dialectic, a different way of talking about development that is different from the one of left and right that has, I think, is a little bit of a discourse that we have used more than enough by now.
Could you send a copy to our premier? You know, he's a professor of economics, so probably he can understand it very well. It's Mario Monti, so maybe you can send a copy of your book.
Absolutely,
to him.
I would love to.
Just do it, please. It can be important now. Andiamo ad Alessandro. Alessandro, parlando anche di quello che ci stava dicendo adesso dell'Italia, I can handle it in English. You know? I'm sorry for my broken English, but I have to do it. And you said that when you make a prediction, you cannot change the course of an hurricane, but you can influence people behaviors. What I mean, this is going to change completely the way we behave when you make a prediction. How is it going to change our lives?
Well, that's the problem that I was mentioning at the end of the talk. So, no, this should work. Okay, this is. Does it work?
I have it, but.
Does it work?
I don't know. It works?
Yes.
Does it work? Yeah, perfect.
Yeah, so the point is that you have, you know, something that is not common in physical systems when you work with social systems, even with economics. At a certain point, when we will start to have quantitative predictions, we will have to factor those in the evolution of the system. And then, of course, they become part of our understanding, and then they have to be put in, again in the way we calculate the evolution of the system. So it's a kind of continuous feedback loop in the process. And again, this is something that for many years people have said that it was not possible to do. I think data, and again, what we can do now with technology is to have a kind of real-time monitoring of what is the social behavior and adaptation, so that we can feedback our models in real time and create somehow simulate this loop in the game.
What about if a prediction goes wrong? I mean, if it's wrong, the social behavior is going to be a disaster.
Yeah, that's one of the problems. This is what you always fight with policymakers and politicians, that usually says, you know, these predictions are very good. They could, if they are right, we could save the world, between quotes. But if they are wrong, then we are accountable for it, and so we do whatever we want anyway. So, you know, I think we have to start. Do you trust weather forecast?
Yes, actually, yes,
yeah.
I do.
And do you know that weather forecast determine, you know, the way you fly it with your planes, et cetera, et cetera. So, well, probably 100 years ago, 150 years ago, people didn't trust weather forecast. So it's just a matter of introducing trust in the population, in the people, in the public, so that you understand that, you know, those are, we need to have those methods become standard in the evaluation of policies and build this trust mechanism. And then I think it will reverberate into the politics and the policy making. So I'm optimistic on that.
Okay, we have to be optimistic. And Alan, I mean, your presentation was terrific, but actually it was a little bit higher for my culture. So I just took so many notes. But the question is coming from the web, from the Twitter. And Cyber Andy is asking you, web cloud, isn't it a peer-to-peer approach, definitely?
Yes. Yeah. I mean,
what is the difference?
It's not a classical peer-to-peer system, and that was you download software and run it on your desktop. That's BitTorrent. That's Nutella, and so forth. And instead, what it is that it's looking at trying to use the useful properties of peer-to-peer systems in the web, where the web is sort of fundamentally a client-server, which is generally the opposite of a peer-to-peer system. So it would be correct to say that it's moving more towards a peer-to-peer distribution system, but it would be incorrect to say it was a perfectly peer-to-peer system.
And I'm quite an active eBay user. Mm-hmm. What should I start doing since today?
Excuse me?
What should I start doing now? I mean, actually,
it's a great question. What I do when I use eBay is not only look at the feedback of the people, like if you're about to buy an item from somebody, you look at his feedback, right? Right now, you probably look at the score. What you should do is look at the people who are providing him feedback.
So the feedback of the feedback.
Yeah, you sort of follow the network, which is essentially what we're doing in a
follow
very automated fashion.
Okay, thank you. Thank you very much. Grazie a Vespignani, Alessandro, grazie a Alan Bislov, grazie a Cesare Hidalgo. Purtroppo, con le vostre presentazioni, siete mangiati, come si dice, il tempo della tavola rotonda. Grazie tante, grazie a tutti e a tutti, grazie a tutte e tre. Voltiamo pagina, intanto torniamo con Ocapi, tocca a te.